Wow, it's game day. Thank you guys, you can have a seat. Yes, it's game day and I'm very happy to be sharing today. I want to encourage you, if you were not a part of last week's message and heard that, that you would go online and check it out because it was an amazing message about the game that we play in life, and Ed did a super job, but I definitely need to make some corrections to some of the things that he said, and you know, that's one of the benefits of me being on the stage today, is I get the microphone and can straighten things out. One thing I will say, though, you know, I don't speak too often, but when I do, it's, you know, I am honored to get to do this, but I want to tell you something. This is not an easy job. And I look at my husband every week as he sits in his study and he has papers all over the place and his Bible is out and he's just putting the effort and the work into it. And I'm just, you know, moseying on through my work and what I do. And today, game day, Sunday for pastors everywhere. I'm just telling you, it is not easy, and he makes it look easy, and so I'm standing up here, and before I correct him, I just want to give him, you know, a little bit of yay, honey, because you do this so well. But enough applause about that. Let me give him some correction. He mentioned last week that I am a true fan of the University of South Carolina Gamecocks. Yes, I am. I am wearing garnet. This is not in honor of A&M. Texas A&M. I just want to tell you, this is garnet for the garnet and black of the South Carolina Gamecocks. But he mentioned the Gamecocks, and he referred to them as game chickens. And I wanted very much to prove him wrong, and so I looked up, what is a gamecock? It is a chicken, but it is a chicken that is bred to fight. Now, I think that is a great word of application, a take home for us, because you may be feeling like a chicken right now, but you are bred for a fight. So let's just, yeah, it's okay. It's okay. We may be chickens, but we're special chickens. We're really special. He also mentioned that the Gamecocks don't win a lot. Yesterday, they didn't win. But that was yesterday. I looked back at the past 5 years for the University of South Carolina Gamecocks in their football program, and I just want to tell you that of the last 5 years, not including this season, there are 38 wins. 36 wins and 28 losses. Okay, now, you know, I didn't major in math or anything, but I can tell you this, 36 is greater than 28. So, seems to me like they're winners. Yeah! Now, I'm a Gamecock because of the influence of my family. I was born and raised in South Carolina. You saw my mom. She's 91 years old. She's 91 years young. And my mom and dad, you know, we grew up there. My dad went to the University of South Carolina. He was a season ticket holder. He, every once in a while, would allow me to use his season tickets. I can tell you that in, I think, 35 plus years that he was a season ticket holder, he only missed one home game. And that was the night that my sister was born. And it took him a while, but he did eventually forgive my mother and my sister for, you know, picking that day to be born. And then later on, my sister, you know, after he had overcome and the bitterness and forgiven them, my sister, though, when she graduated from high school, she enrolled in Clemson University. And if you know anything about South Carolina, you know that Clemson is not the school of choice in the state of South Carolina. It is the University of South Carolina. So that was pretty traumatic. But after a year, she figured out what the best choice in life was, and she enrolled in the University of South Carolina. My dad forgave, and all is well in the Lee household. He taught me about the game. He taught me about winning, because if you look at football and you look at sports in general, it's about winning. We're attracted to winning. And if you watch Gameday, I love to watch Gameday. I love to see the analyst. They look at every detail about the teams that will be playing on Saturday. And they look at the stats and what this team did last week and that team did last week. And now they're against each other. And what will the outcome be? Who will be the winner? And they try to predict it. And I thought, what in the world? What if they could fix it so their prediction would come true? I think pretty much that would be against NCAA regulations. There would probably be probation. There would be some penalties. That would not be good. You can't do that. You can't fix the winner in a football game. God, though, fixed it for you and I to be winners in the game of life. He fixed it through his son Jesus and allowed us to become winners. It's about winning. Why did I become a follower of Christ? I want to tell you why I became a Christian. At the age of 9, I wasn't into any really spectacular sinning. I mean, I obviously was a little kid who was mischievous at times, but I mean, I wasn't like off, you know, the grid as far as sinning goes, sinning meaning doing things wrong. But I came to a point where I realized that, you know, I needed a relationship with Jesus. And I remember hearing our pastor speak. And as he would talk, and I went to a church where the pastor was real animated, and he would just get all up in your grill, and his face would turn red. I remember one time when I was a kid, I asked my mom, I said, is that what a heart attack looks like? I thought the pastor was having a heart attack because he was just preaching, and if you didn't, you know, turn, you were going to burn, and if you didn't make a decision to follow Jesus, you weren't going to heaven, you were going to go to hell. And honestly, I just wanted to go to heaven. And so I accepted Jesus into my life as a child, and really my motivation was stay out of hell. I wanted to go to heaven. That was what winning looked like for me. And as followers of Christ, those of us who have made that decision to cross over the line and receive what Jesus has done on the cross for us, that involves two types of winning. Two types of winning. The first is winning in our eternity. And that was what I was all about. I wanted to win in knowing that I was going to spend my life after death in heaven. That was winning. Winning eternally. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life, Christ Jesus our Lord." We have an opportunity to win eternally. What is winning? Winning is victory over an adversary. And when we spend our lives committed to Jesus Christ, when we make that decision to follow him, we win over death. For the wages of sin is what? Death. So we have victory over death. That was the adversary. We're winning eternally, but we're also winning every single day. You see, I was focused at that point in my life as a 9-year-old child on winning eternally, but what I did not realize was I was thinking about the end of my life, but it wasn't just about the end. It was the beginning. In fact, the end was the beginning. When I gave my life to Christ, that's when I was on the line of scrimmage. It was 1st and 10. I'm ready to go. You're attracted to winners. I'm attracted to winning. There's nothing like your team winning. Yesterday, I did not experience that as the University of South Carolina was defeated just momentarily by the Aggies, the Texas Aggies. I don't know what your team is. If you're in Florida, you know, the U, yay. We pull for the U. Oklahoma, Norman, Landry, Brad, Sterling, those Sooners. I think they had a bye yesterday. Whatever your team. I mean, let's just face it. Aren't you happy when they win? Yes, we're attracted to winners. We're attracted to winners. The children of Israel, God's chosen people, found themselves in slavery for 430 years in Egypt. 430 years they lived under the rule of Pharaoh, building the city, living in poor conditions, having to struggle every single day under that pressing of the Egyptian rule. That was not winning for them. They were in bondage and slavery. They were living a life of hardship. And God said, I'm going to deliver you out of the hands of the Egyptians. I'm going to take you to a place that is, I promise you, will have milk and honey and everything you need. The promised land. And so as Moses was God's point man to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt, God said, you get ready because I'm getting ready to show you deliverance. I'm going to show you what winning is all about. God, in Exodus chapter 3, verse 8, said, so I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. The children of Israel were going to win. As they were leaving the promised land, God did all of these miraculous things in front of them and in front of Pharaoh. And Pharaoh finally just says, get out of Dodge. Get out of my land because your God is just wreaking havoc over us. And so they were delivered. They won. They had victory over their bondage, victory over their situation. So they leave and they go into the wilderness on what was to be a 40-day journey. 40 days, say 40 days. 40 days. It ended up being a 40-year journey. Have you ever started out on a road trip and expected it to be one amount of time, and it ended up being a whole lot more time? I doubt any of us could say that we were going for a four-hour trip that ended up to be a four-day trip, let alone a 40-day trip that ended up being a 40-year trip. It's crazy. They got confused in their deliverance. They forgot what winning looks like. You see, they understood that God had brought them out of the land, but they didn't understand how to live every day after. Maybe you've experienced the victory over the adversary of death, and you call yourself a Christian, but are you wandering in the desert like the children of Israel wandered? What would it take to live a victorious life? Because we're on the line of scrimmage. And it's all about forward progress. Don't you just get really nervous when your team is playing and the quarterback drops back in the pocket? Aren't you impressed? I mean, literally, this girl up here is telling you a little bit about the pocket and the line of scrimmage. I mean, I'm impressed with myself a little bit, I'm just going to say. So shout out to all the girls who watch football. But they drop back. And the further back they go, you're thinking, let the ball go. Get it out of your hands. Come on now. Forward progress. Forward progress. Or how about when there's a handoff and the guy who, now I'm really shooting myself in the foot because I can't think of the name of the position of the guy who gets the ball and goes forward. Yeah, running back. That's what he does. Thank you. Whew. Appreciate that. The running back gets the ball, but he runs so far to the right or so far to the left, then you're like, you're working too hard in the wrong direction. Go that way. And you want to help him out so bad. Yes, it's all about forward progress. That's winning. Are you more in love with Jesus today than you were yesterday? Forward progress. Is your life more like Christ today than it was the day you accepted him as your Savior? Forward progress. Gosh, these are hard questions because too many of us who call ourselves Christians are wandering, and we've forgotten that winning is not only about the end, it's about right now. People are attracted to winners. We like to win. When your life is being viewed by others, do people see winners? Or do they see wanderers? What does it look like to live a victorious life? Living in victory, I want to just give you a few handles. Living in victory every single day of your life as a follower of Christ, living in victory means you face oppositions and adversaries.
Halftime. Welcome back to the Gameday Halftime Show. Thanks for joining us.
That's right. This halftime show is sponsored by the Canton Flea Market, TJ Maxx Home Goods, and thrift stores nationwide.
Now, Derek, let's get right into it. Let's talk about the biggest surprise of this first half. I'm going to go ahead and say that it's Lisa's not wearing either camo or leopard print. That's impressive. Threw me for a ride.
Amazing.
There's a first time for everything. And by the way, we got to talk about what's happened here, a history of this in the past, right? What could happen? Remember Dak Prescott, Tony Romo?
That's right, Tim. When a leader goes down, another great leader always steps up, and we've seen that happen today.
Agreed, Derek. I wouldn't be surprised if this game continues to go the way it is and Lisa takes the starting position as speaker.
We've seen a lot of great plays so far. What do you think Lisa needs to do to improve the second half?
You know, Tim, we had a long list of critiques that we were going to talk about, but then we remembered that Lisa is our boss's wife.
And she's my mother-in-law. So that was the best message I've ever heard in my entire life. Phenomenal. No critiques.
I got nothing. It was flawless. It was amazing. And honestly, I'm hoping that she speaks longer than her a lot of time.
Agreed, Derek. And is it just me, or does she look 30 years old? Wow.
Sam,
incredible.
I was going to say 25, but let's just call it 27.
Hey, I think I see Lisa coming down to the tunnel right now.
Oh, before we do, Tim, Lisa has a nickname in our family, and it's Muzzard, so we need to get a Muzzard chant. We need all campuses involved. Here we go.
Let's do it.
Muzzard, 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 Muzzard.
All right, it's time for the second half. Let's hear it for the second half of game day.
Wow, they let the cat out of the bag. My nickname is Muzzard. I mean, really. Ed loves nicknames, and for some reason, he named me Muzzard. And he'll ask the kids, he'll say, you know, he'll go up to them and say, how's your Muzzard? He just, you know, he'll even call them and leave a voicemail. Laurie, how's your Muzzard? I mean, welcome to my life. But the cool thing is my grandma name is Muzzy, and I think that's really cute. Okay. I think we were talking about how to live a victorious life. Yeah, and it meant that we come up against our adversaries. The verse that I gave you just a few minutes ago about, you know, God was going to deliver the children of Israel into the land of milk and honey, the land that everybody would have everything they possibly needed because God provided it. Now, let me just set the record straight. Some people think that when you hear promised land, it's talking about heaven. No, it's talking about earth. It's talking about the children of Israel were going to dwell there. God intended for them to leave Egypt, spend 40 days as a journey, and live in the promised land. That was not heaven. That was earth. God intends for us to receive him and then live on earth with his provision. But it doesn't come without opposition. In fact, the latter part of that verse says that the land was filled with people. I'll just read them. They were every kind of ite you would want to know. The Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, or the Jebusites. There was a land of opposition. They were going to face things. You know, so often we think, oh, I gave my life to Jesus, and now it's going to be a primrose path. No, no. You're going to face difficulties, but your difficulties will not define you. You're destined for difficulty, but your difficulties are not your destiny. God will use your difficulties in order to work in your life. This past week, I woke up on Monday. You know, there's always a joke about, oh, it's Monday. Everybody, whoa, we don't like Monday. Well, I woke up on Monday, and this was a Monday I didn't like because I just kept getting news. Different things were happening, and it wasn't according to my game plan. Stuff was happening bad, wrong. I didn't like it, and it was messing with my mojo. And, I got into this woe is me, and I looked like anything but a winner. If somebody was looking, a spectator looking from the outside in, they'd be going, oh, whoa, is that what Christianity looks like? I'm not sure if that's what I want, because that's not winning. Have you ever had a Monday like that? Maybe a Tuesday, a Wednesday, a Thursday, a Friday, Saturday, Sunday like that? Yeah, we all have. What do you do when you face opposition, when you face a difficulty, when things just aren't going your way? Well, I want to just give you a few little things that I try to do. First of all, before I do that, let me share with you Hebrews 10:32. It says, remember those early days after you had received the light. The light means Jesus. When you stood your ground in a great contest in the face of suffering. So this is a natural progress. We're going to face suffering. Here's just three little things to do when you're facing opposition. Number one, look at the problem in light of God's purpose. You see, my life is not about my purposes. It's about God's purpose. When I became a Christ follower, things changed. It stopped being about me and started being about Him. That's the perspective that we should have as followers, as people in the light. So it's all about understanding God's purpose. Do you know God is strongest when I am weakest because I depend on Him so much more? And I have to move from that, well, why me mentality to what now, God? Anytime something has happened in my life where I've faced a difficulty, whether it's an illness or a challenge with work or something to do with our family, just a struggle, it's easy to camp out in why me. Emotionally speaking, why me, God? I don't understand why me. And it's okay to say why me as long as you don't camp out there very long, as long as you just don't go around in circles wandering around the why me camp. You've got to move to what now, God? Show me your purpose in this situation. Also, I remember past problems and how God has provided. That's why I love to journal. Ed actually taught me that. We have journals of his from when he was in junior high. Keeping track of what God is showing us on a daily basis and writing down those things that maybe you're dealing with, a difficulty, and putting it on a pencil to paper and putting it in that book. And then you go back and say, but this is how God worked through that situation. And so I look at that and go, oh my goodness, how great is our God that He doesn't leave me in a lurch, but He actually has fulfilled this in the past. And I know that today He's working to make it bring Him glory in the future. I mean, the Gamecocks, they did not win yesterday, but I look back at the 5-year history and I go, well, I'm a winner because in the past we won. We may not have won yesterday, but in the past we did. And so you have to think about it from that perspective. And then the third thing I do is I start to pray. Prayer. I pray over my situation, but then I pray for others. One of the best things that you and I can do to move us from why me to what now is to think about the needs of others. I love to think about myself. I love to think about what I'm dealing with and what I'm going through. But I can tell you, when I start thinking about others, it changes everything. Because that Monday, this past Monday, the news was all about a limo crash where 18 people were killed in upstate New York. It was all about the hurricane that was to hit Florida, where many people lost not only their possessions, but lives. You see, I have friends who are going through difficult health situations, cancer, and I'm like, God, those things loom so much larger than the situation I'm going through. And maybe your situation is just as big and bad, but God will use this as an opportunity to show others, the spectators in your world, that you're winning. It can be a moment of victory for you. Living in victory means you're part of a team, and I am so very, very thankful for the Fellowship Church team, because throughout my life, when the going gets tough, this place has been the safe haven for me and our family. And I want to encourage you to not let this just be a destination on a Sunday, but a part of your life every single day. It's your team. You're a part of a team. When the children of Israel faced those battles to take the land, the promised land, which there were many, they fought the Amalek. He was the warrior that they were up against. And Moses went up to the mountain to pray, while Joshua was in the valley fighting Amalek. When Moses went to pray, Aaron and Hur went with him. And the Bible says, the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, it says that when Moses got tired, Aaron and Hur put a rock underneath him so that he could sit down. He was praying over the battle. And when Moses would pray, Joshua would win. When Moses stopped praying, Amalek would win. So it was real important for the victory that Moses would pray. And when he got tired, Aaron and Hur put this rock underneath him so that he could sit down. And then they lifted his hands so that he could continue to pray and Joshua could continue to succeed in battle. Who are your Aaron and Hur? Are you surrounded by people who are like-minded in faith, who are holding you up in your time of need? Just some things to think about, but pray. Living in victory means you're part of a team. Living in victory also means you have a playbook. How crazy would it be if a team took the field and didn't know the playbook? I'm astonished, and I'm just going to be a little bit on a rant right now. I'm astonished at the number of people who call themselves Christians and have no familiarity with God's word, this playbook. Life is going tough, and you feel defeated, and you're like, well, I don't understand. I don't know. Do you know the playbook? Have you read the last pages? Have you read the pages that tell you how to live day to day? I mean, what playbook are you operating on? Is it the news media? Is it conversations from people who don't love God? I mean, what is it? Years ago, when Ed and I were first married, he was involved in these basketball leagues at our church, much like the FC Sports Ministry. And after the evenings of playing basketball or whatever, he would gather with some of the guys. And there was one particular guy named Phil. And Phil was a great athlete, great player. And Ed had developed a little bit of a relationship with him. And he said, Phil, I want to talk to you a little bit. And so they went into Ed's office. And he said, Phil, I want to talk to you about your family and, your life and whatever. And Ed found out, and he had expected this, that Phil was not a Christian. So he talked to Phil about that. And in that office, after a night of playing basketball, Phil asked Christ to come into his life. Subsequently, Phil's wife, who was dealing with addiction at the time, became a follower of Christ as well. His brother became a follower of Christ, just one after the other. His in-laws, his father, his mom was not in the picture, just one by one. Later that week, we were watching television, and the phone rang, and it was a rotary phone, a landline phone. So you millennials, y'all look that up. So that meant we had to get off the sofa and go to where the phone was to pick it up. So the phone rang and it was Phil. And Phil said, Ed, I'm reading this, the Bible. You told me to read the Bible. You know, you said that that's how I'm going to grow in my faith and my walk with God. And I'm reading this and I'm, Ed, so you're saying that God separated the Red Sea so the children of Israel could go through. And then after they got through and Pharaoh was chasing after them, God caused the sea to close up over Pharaoh. That really happened. Ed said, yeah, Phil, that really happened. And he just started going through different things in the Bible that he had been reading the first week he was saved. The first week that he had come into a relationship with God, because he looked at this book as, I'm not going to let this go by. This is the greatest tool I have. And one by one, he started naming these stories and going, oh my goodness, this is my God? The playbook. We have got to live like winners because of what this book says about us. It also says living in victory. Living in victory means you're coachable. Have you ever noticed on the sidelines how everybody's wired in with these very expensive headsets and stuff? You know, the communication on the sidelines of a football game are unbelievable. I mean, you can no longer put the bucket of ice or Kool-Aid or whatever on top of somebody unless you first make sure that they have their audio equipment off, because that's very expensive. I don't know. But it's all about communication. God uses individuals to teach us and coach us in life, whether it's through a connect group, whether it's through a small group leader, but he wants to teach you and critique you so that you have forward progress in your life. And if you're like me, I don't like to hear the hard stuff. In fact, I like to blame other people for when I mess up. No, it was them. It was him. It was her. It was that boss or that teacher, assuming responsibility, being coachable, is the step toward forward progress. All of these things help us live that victory every day. And people will look at our lives and go, wow, that's what winning looks like. Otherwise, we look like everybody else. I want to look like a winner. I want to move in the right direction, the direction that God wants me to move. When Landra, one of our twin daughters, was 4 years old, she played soccer. And, you know, kids soccer is awesome because it's, you know, it's basically herding. Everybody's, you know, they're not all over in their positions. They're just all together and they move in a huddle this way and this way and this way. And somewhere the ball is in there. Well, Landra, I mean, every day she and Laurie would wake up, you know, on Saturday mornings and we'd be getting ready for the game. And it was game day in the Young household because it was the soccer day. And I think we call that European football or something. But it was the soccer game and the uniform. Oh, my goodness. They loved the uniform. We had to teach them that when you're running up and down the field, you can't just look down at yourself to see how you're dressed. I mean, they loved the uniform. And Landra was so excited, and she was doing pretty good. I mean, she has pretty good, you know, motor skills, and she was moving around and doing well. And she one day broke out of that little huddle thing, and she started toward the goal. And she's kicking and going and going, and we're just like, oh, my goodness, look at her. And she scored in the wrong goal. Coach brought her over to the side. You know, Ed and I were trying to do that good parent thing and not get involved. And we were like, oh my goodness, to ourselves. And the coach said, Landra, this is our goal down here. They go back out there. She did it again. Like, wow, the kid is talented, but just in the wrong direction. Finally, she learned the right direction, which goal to focus on. And she eventually scored. Do you know the goal that is ahead of you as a follower of Christ? Do you know what direction you're supposed to be going in? And are you doing it as a winner? Because that's the plan and the intention that God has for every single one of us. It's not just about the end. It's about the here and the now. Living victorious because Jesus fixed it for you and me. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this time that we can gather. And I pray that this is just a holy huddle where we can break and go out into the world and show people what a real, thriving, victorious life with you is all about. Father, I ask your forgiveness for the times when I get so caught up in myself that I forget all that you've done for me, how you've provided for my eternity, but you provided for me with milk and honey in the land that I'm dwelling right now. Help me to live as a winner. And Father, right now I pray that those who are hearing my voice in all of our different environments, and they don't understand what winning eternally is all about, that right now you would take this moment. If you're hearing my voice and you don't know what that's like, you don't know what it's like to have your eternity secured, right now just say to yourself, God, I want to be on your team. I want to win every single day of my life. And I know that Jesus fixed that for me, and I receive his forgiveness and his power and provision. I receive that right now, and I want to walk every day toward the goal that you put before me. God, we thank you so much for every single person in this place and all of our different locations. We thank you that you are working in us and you have provided for us. You are our great God, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.